Hope you all are able to see my screen now. Yes, we start with endocrine system. See, the endocrine system, it includes endocrine glands and their hormones, as you all know. So what are the functions of hormones? Hormones are secreted by some glands, and these hormones are traveled to the bloodstream, and they show their function in specific parts of the body. So the functions of the endocrine system is to secrete hormones into the bloodstream. That is the function of endocrine system. So what is a hormone? A hormone is a chemical messenger which targets a specific group of cells, and when it targets a specific group of cells, it will cause some activity. It will show its activity there. So the activity might be positive response, and the activity might be a negative response also. So it will show its activity on the specific target cell. That is a hormone. A hormone is a chemical messenger which will target a specific group of cells. So what are those endocrine glands present in our body? So these are different endocrine glands. Pineal gland, which is present in the brain, pineal and pituitary glands, these both are present in the brain. And one is thyroid gland, which is present in the region of neck. Another is thymus, which is present in the region of chest. We'll see the specific locations. I'm just telling you. And adrenal glands, which are present on the kidneys, both the kidneys and pancreas. And you know that both testes and ovaries, these are reproductive glands. These are the glands which are present in the body, endocrine glands. Exocrine glands are also present, like pancreas. Pancreas is a mixocrine gland. It is both exocrine and endocrine, right? Yeah. So we'll discuss each one of them in detail. So first let us see what are exocrine glands and endocrine glands, the difference between exocrine and endocrine glands. Exocrine glands release their secretions into the tubes. Endocrine glands, they are ductless glands. They will secrete their hormones or secretions into blood directly. You can see a few examples of exocrine glands. Liver, it is an exocrine gland. It will secrete bile juice, which is released into gallbladder. Then through the duct, it will release them, or it will move through the small intestine. And pancreas, as I told, pancreas are mixocrine glands. They are both exocrine and endocrine nature. Exocrine nature, what is the exocrine nature of pancreas is? It releases pancreatic juice into the small intestine. And that is also via ducts. That is about exocrine gland. Endocrine glands, as you all know, they are ductless glands. They release their hormones directly into the bloodstream. And blood, acting as a medium, it'll transport those hormones to different parts of the body, to the target cells. Okay, each hormone acts only on certain kind of tissues, and that certain kind of tissues are called as target tissues. Yes, next you can see here, each hormone acts on certain kind of tissues called as target tissues. So what are the target tissues? Now you can see here, it is an endocrine gland. It is secreting certain hormones. So this is the donor cell of hormone. It is secreting its hormones into the bloodstream. This is the blood vessel, the pink color one. And it is sending, this gland is secreting the hormones into the bloodstream. The blue color one is a hormone. So the molecules of hormones are traveling to the blood. And you can see here, there is a receptor. This is the target cell. And the target cell have its receptor. And this chemical messenger, that is a hormone, it will go and bind to the receptor here, and it will show it activity on this target cell. And you can see here also the same is happening. This is about endocrine glands and endocrine system. All endocrine glands will function in the same way. This is the mechanism. When it is asked for 2 marks, you can represent what is endocrine gland or endocrine system. You can represent it with this diagram. So it would be easily understood by the examiner. Okay, clear?
Ma'am, does this do these receptors exist on every target cell, or is it only a few of them?
Receptors are present on every target cell. Otherwise, nobody can read the chemical messenger. So it requires a receptor which can read the hormone.
And
Okay.
ma'am, the volume of the hormones, is it enough to bind to every target cell's receptor?
Yeah, the quantity is very less. So it is specific to each cell, right? The hormone, whichever is secreting, it is specific to each cell. So that would be enough for identification. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Ma'am, can you define hormone?
A hormone is a chemical messenger. You can see it here. A hormone is a chemical messenger which target a specific group of cells. And it in order to cause that group of cells to do some activity or to stop doing an activity. So a hormone can show a positive response or a negative response also. Okay, it will show some activity irrespective of it is a positive or negative. We'll see what is the positive response or what are the negative responses also when we see them in detail. Okay. Yeah, these are the glands I have already told you: pituitary, pineal, thyroid, parathyroid, adrenal, pancreas, testes, and ovaries. These are the different glands. We'll study each one of them in detail. Yeah. So first let us study which is a very very important gland, pituitary gland. When you study these glands, important thing is you need to remember their location, where are they present. Second thing, what are the hormones they are secreting? Let me write it down here. So when you study those hormones, what are the things to be remembered? First one, location. And second thing is hormones secreted by them. Third one is function. And fourth one, disorders. Disorders are not required for all. It is required only for few glands that I will mention it here. Okay, these are the four things you need to remember: location, hormone secreted, function, and disorders. Guys, I'll request you all to keep to be in mute. Otherwise, it will be disturbance for others. Okay. So first, let us see the pituitary gland, which is very important. Pituitary gland is a round organ and its size is about a pea, approximately 1 centimeter in diameter. So it is located in brain, as you all know, but where is the specific location? Located behind the bridge of the nose at the base of the brain. This is the exact location. So it is present in the brain. So what are the hormones that are secreted by pituitary gland? Pituitary gland secretes 9 different hormones which affect different areas of the body. Pituitary gland have two lobes. As you all know, pituitary gland So, pituitary gland have two lobes. What are those two lobes? Anterior pituitary and posterior pituitary. Anterior and posterior pituitary. So, this is how the structure looks like. So one is anterior pituitary, other one is posterior pituitary. So anterior pituitary secretes growth hormone, MSH, LSH, follicle FSH. Okay, all these hormones are secreted by anterior pituitary. Posterior pituitary secretes only two hormones. Those hormones are one is vasopressin, antidiuretic hormone. Second one is oxytocin. Only these are the two hormones that are secreted by posterior pituitary. The rest of the hormones are secreted by anterior pituitary only. So these are the secreting, it secretes 9 different hormones which affect many different areas of body. Those many different areas are, it affects the growth of the human body, it affects the blood pressure, it regulates the pregnancy, you know, oxytocin, FSH, all this regulates pregnancy, breast or milk production, and it also regulates the gonads, sex organs, both in men and women. It regulates the thyroid gland. It regulates the metabolism of the body, carbohydrate metabolism, protein metabolism, and lipid metabolism of the body. It regulates water level in the body. It also regulates temperature. These are the main functions of the pituitary gland. One is growth, blood pressure, pregnancy regulation, milk production. It regulates gonads, thyroid gland, metabolism, water level regulation, and temperature regulation. These are the functions of pituitary gland. So let's see here. These are the hormones secreted by anterior pituitary. Growth hormone. Growth hormone is somatotropin, which promotes the growth. Somatostatin, which inhibits the growth. So growth hormone to increase the body size during childhood and adolescence. It also maintains the body size during adulthood. This is the function of growth hormone. Next one is thyroid stimulating hormone. It secretes a hormone known as thyrotrophin. Thyrotrophins are divided into two types, T3 and T4. T3 and T4, triiodothyronine and tetraiodothyronine. And the function is to stimulate the thyroid to produce thyroxine. What is the function of thyroid gland? You know. Okay. Follicle stimulating hormone, FSH. It regulates the puberty, development, or reproductive process. FSH and LH have more functions on menstrual cycle. So luteinizing hormone, it stimulates the production of estrogen and testosterone. Okay. So I have told you the disorders of growth hormone, like disorders of each gland is important. So growth hormone, the over secretion or the hyper secretion of growth hormone leads to a disorder known as zygantism, okay, in childhood, and acromegaly in adults. Zygantism means the excessive growth will be seen in those people. Zygantism in childhood and acromegaly in adults. Okay, hyposecretion means under secretion of growth hormone leads to dwarfism. These are the disorders of growth hormone. Okay, next is thyroid gland. So this thyroid gland is located in the neck, in the region of neck. As you can see here, this thyroid gland is located, and it releases a hormone, thyroxine. What is the function of this thyroxine hormone? It basically regulates the rate of metabolism in the body. Metabolic rate is regulated, like carbohydrate metabolism is regulated. Okay. So what it is essential for normal physical and mental development also. So over secretion of thyroxine results in nervousness and weight loss. Under secretion, hyposecretion leads to cretinism. So it is mental retardation in children. Okay. These are the disorders of thyroid gland, and these are the functions. My function is mainly to regulate metabolism. Okay. So here you can see it leads to goiter also. Iodine deficiency in your diet results in goiter, which leads to enlargement of thyroid gland. You can see in the picture here the enlargement, which it is the normal case, and it is the in the patient who have goiter. Goiter is caused by iodine deficiency. Done. So next is parathyroid gland, and just behind the thyroid gland, parathyroid glands are present as 4 lobes. So what are the functions located here? So it is located behind the thyroid gland in the neck region itself, just behind this. You can see here, parathyroid gland as 4 small glands it is located. So it is also helpful in metabolism, and also it regulates the level of calcium. It regulates the level of calcium, and it is necessary for normal nerve and muscle function, blood clotting and healthy bones and teeth, as it regulates the calcium metabolism. Calcium is very important in the nervous system. For a neuron to carry impulse from one neuron to the other neuron, you know, in the synapse, calcium is very required, very much essential. If calcium gates do not open and calcium is not sent towards the nerve endings, the hormone, like what are the messages, cannot be sent from one neuron to the next neuron. That is how calcium plays very important role in the nervous system. And same happens in the muscle. And muscle, if you know muscle mechanism for troponin and tropomyosin to function, again calcium plays a very, very important role. And in blood clotting, yes, it is very much essential. And bones and teeth, you know, it is a component of bones and teeth. Those are the functions of parathyroid gland. And the hormone released by parathyroid gland is parath hormone. So under secretion, hyposecretion of this hormone again results in brittle bone disorder and blood clotting problems and nerve disorders. These are few disorders of parathyroid gland. Hope everyone are able to follow. Yeah. And next is adrenal gland. Yeah, adrenal gland, it is, you can see here, as these adrenal glands are located on the top of the kidneys like a hat. So located on the top of each kidney, hormones released by this adrenal gland is cortisone. It is not cortisol, cortisone and adrenaline. Okay. Functions of cortisone is to regulate carbohydrate, protein and fat metabolism, same as thyroid gland, and it promotes conversion of fats and proteins to glucose. Okay. And the functions of adrenaline is to raise the blood sugar levels and increase the heartbeat and breathing rates. This is also, cortisone will help in metabolism and adrenaline will help in blood sugar regulation and heartbeat regulation. So this is the function of adrenal gland. So hyposecretion of these adrenaline hormone, it results in the inability to deal with stress. The people with less adrenaline cannot deal with stress. Okay. Next is pancreas. Pancreas, I told, it has both endocrine function and exocrine function. As pancreas secrete bile juice, that is exocrine function. When comes to insulin and glucagon, these are endocrine hormones, and that is secreted only by islets of Langerhans. Okay, so there are alpha cells and beta cells present in the pancreas. Beta cells, which has islets of Langerhans, it secretes insulin and glucagon. As you can see here, located on pancreas, the hormones secreted are insulin and glucagon, and insulin and glucagon very much required for the regulation of blood sugar levels in the body.
What do alpha cells do?
That has exocrine function. Beta cells have endocrine function. Yeah, insulin, it stimulates the glucose uptake from the cells, and glucagon, it promotes the glycogen to glucose. Both of these have antagonistic functions. They function in opposite way, so that if one will increase the blood sugar level, other one will decrease the blood sugar level. Okay, so they can balance the blood sugar level in the body. So insulin and glucagon are blood sugar regulating hormones, and they are very much essential for sugar level regulation. Clear? Yes. Yeah. And over secretion of insulin results in low blood sugar. Okay, because it uptake, insulin will uptake the sugar from the blood cells. Under secretion of it results in high blood sugar. You can see this in the case of diabetic patients. There is impairment in insulin secretion in those particular patients, so they have very high blood sugar. Okay, and this can lead to the condition known as diabetes. Yeah, there are two different types, diabetes type 1 and type 2, which are not required in detail. I have just kept it to discuss. Type 1 and type 2, diabetes are present, and type 1, which has frequent urination and thirst, extreme hunger and unusual weight loss, extreme fatigue and irritability. These are few symptoms of the patients having diabetes. Okay, and see, it refer, the symptoms differ from diabetes type 1 to diabetes type 2. See, here in diabetes type 2, it has blurred vision also. Yeah, so few symptoms that frequent urination is present in diabetes type 2 also. And apart from that, blurred vision is also present, and numbness of hands and feet, that is one more thing which is more important in diabetes type 2. So these are few things about endocrine system. Yes, and this is regulated. Endocrine system and endocrine hormones are basically regulated by feedback inhibition, feedback mechanism. Positive feedback will increase the secretion of those hormones. Negative feedback will decrease the secretion of those hormones. As I told, they have both positive function and negative function. Positive feedback helps in increasing the level of the hormone. Negative feedback helps in decreasing the level of the hormone. Okay, and let me show you. Yes, I need to show this. Yes, please be thorough with this particular table. Thyroid will secrete two hormones, thyroxine and calcitonin, and as I told, they regulate the metabolism. Parathyroid secretes parath hormone. It stimulates the release of calcium from bones. Yes, again, as insulin and glucagon, calcitonin and parath hormone are antagonistic in function. They help in regulating. One will increase the level, one will decrease the level. So it is stimulating. Parath hormone is stimulating the calcium from bones, and this is inhibiting. So both of these will function antagonistic to each other. Yes, pancreas, islets of Langerhans, it secretes hormones, insulin and glucagon. Again, both of these will help in regulating the blood sugar level. Adrenal, see, adrenal gland is again divided into adrenal cortex and adrenal medulla. Adrenal cortex release the hormone epinephrine, and it is responsible for stress response. Guys, keep yourself in mute. Kritika Narayan. Yes, and yeah, next is pineal gland. Pineal gland, it secretes a hormone which is present in brain. Pineal gland, as I shown you, it is present in brain. It secretes a hormone, melatonin. It helps in regulation of sleep cycle. Okay, and yeah, TSH, thyroid stimulating hormone. It stimulates release of thyroxine, a growth hormone. It stimulates growth during infancy and puberty. Antidiuretic hormone, ADH, which is secreted by posterior pituitary gland. It helps in like regulation of water level. Kidneys, it helps in many, basically the, it increases or decreases the function of, or regulates the level of water in the kidney. Okay, oxytocin, it affects the childbirth and even during lactation for secreting the milk, and also for uterine contractions during labor. These are functions of hormones. Yes, so this is about endocrine system. If you have any doubts in endocrine system, I'll give you 2 minutes. I'll go through if you have any questions here. If you have any doubts, yeah, you can ask those doubts also in 2 minutes. If you don't have any doubts, we'll go to the nervous system. Yeah, hypothalamus is not there in your syllabus, but hypothalamus is known as master gland for pituitary gland. Hypothalamus regulates pituitary. Let me draw a flowchart and show how it regulates exactly. Hypothalamus releases hormones known as releasing hormones, and releasing hormones in turn induce this pituitary gland. So pituitary gland, as I told here, it has anterior pituitary and posterior pituitary. Let us take adrenocorticotropic hormone, ACTH, or thyroid stimulating hormone. These are the hormones of pituitary gland secreted by anterior pituitary, right? Hypothalamus will secrete adrenocorticotropic releasing hormones and thyroxine releasing hormones. So this adrenocorticotropic hormone will induce this ACTH. Thyroid stimulating hormone will induce TSH. So that is the function of hypothalamus. That is why it is called as master gland of pituitary gland. Pituitary gland is a master gland for rest of the glands. Hypothalamus is a master gland for pituitary gland. Okay, and let me check for other doubts. Adrenal medulla. See, adrenal gland, yes, it is divided into adrenal cortex and adrenal medulla. Medulla have gonadotrophic hormones. Gonadotrophic hormones will help in reproductive system regulation of those hormones, estrogen, progesterone, and testosterone. Adrenal cortex is mainly for this stress response, flight and fight response. The function of hypothalamus is to regulate pituitary gland. Okay. Yeah, parts of the brain will be explained in nervous system. Okay, fine. I cannot see any other doubts. Hope all doubts are cleared. Okay, next let us go to nervous system. Yeah, first thing, when you go to nervous system, you need to know what is stimulus. Stimulus is a change in the environment to which living organisms respond. Okay, to any change in and around us, we respond to it. Then that is known as stimuli. For example, we respond to heat and we respond to cold. Now it is very cold here, so we use jerkins to prevent ourselves. We use sweaters.
Ma'am?
Yes?
Ma'am, there's two more doubts in the chat box. We just add before you close the thing. Check.
Yes, let me check. How does adrenal detach itself from the receptors of cells? I didn't get the question, Anurag. What is the question? Can you ask it?
It's just a little above. Yeah, he means how does the body reuse the adrenaline hormone?
That will be discussed little later, Anurag. We'll discuss it in personal. It is a very lengthy topic. Okay. Yes, coming back to nervous system, the changes that is happening in the environment to which living organisms respond is known as stimuli. A few examples of stimulus are heat, cold, and our response to sound, smell, taste, All these are different stimulus. Okay, living organisms respond to stimuli in the form of body movements. Yes, and what is coordination? So, you know, let's take from bacteria to human beings, the complexity or organization of the body is increasing. Like in bacteria, not much organization is required as it is very a small organism. But in human beings and other mammals, if you take the complexity has highly increased, but we are completely organized and controlled, right? Because this organization is done by nervous system and endocrine system. So what is coordination? For a proper response to the stimuli, many organs in our body should work together. If one is not functioning properly, we might not respond to the stimuli correctly or properly. So the coordination should be there to function or to respond to the stimuli. The working together of various organs in an organism to produce a proper response is known as to a stimuli is known as coordination. Okay? The working together of various organs to respond to a stimuli, that is known as coordination. In animals, yes, control and coordination is done by the nervous system and endocrine system. And in plants, it is done by plant hormones. Phytohormones we'll see in the later part of our class. Okay. So coming to receptors, the receptors, these are very important. These definitions are very important, like coordination, stimulus, and receptors. Receptors are the sense organs which receive the stimuli and pass the message to the brain or spinal cord through different nerves. Okay? Receptors are the sense organs which they receive the stimulus from an organ. They receive the stimulus. That stimuli is passed to brain or spinal cord. And brain and spinal cord start responding to that particular stimuli. That is a receptor. Okay. There are different types of receptors. Here, for example, we have photoreceptors which respond or detect the light. Photoreceptors are present in eye. Phonoreceptors. These are the receptors that detect the sound. Okay. Olfactory receptors which are present in nose and these detect the smell. Gustatory receptors are present in tongue and they detect the taste. Tango receptors are present on the skin to detect touch. So these are different receptors and five sense organs which respond to different stimuli. Okay, now we need to know what is effector and effector. There is difference between effector and effector. The difference between effector and effector. So let's see what is effector and effector. See, effectors are the muscles or glands which respond to the information from the brain and spinal cord. Okay, so effector is basically the organ from where the stimulus is sent. Okay, it is basically the receptor from where the stimulus is sent. Okay. So, effector will send the information to the brain or spinal cord. This spinal cord or brain will take the information and give it to one particular organ that have few receptors which respond to it. Those are effectors. Okay, effectors will send the information. Effectors will receive the information. Okay, that is the difference between effectors and effectors. Okay, and there are two different types of nerves also. One are sensory nerves, one is motor nerve and other is a mixed nerve also. So we'll discuss what is sensory, what is motor, what is mixed nerves. Sensory nerves are the nerves which carry information from the receptor to the brain and spinal cord. These are basically effectors. Please keep yourself in mute. Yes, basically sensory nerves are the nerves which take information from the organ to the brain or spinal cord. Motor nerves, they carry back information from the brain and spinal cord and give it to muscles or different glands. These are basically effectors. Okay, so those are for effector. The example is sensory nerve. For the effector, the example is motor nerve. Okay, and there are mixer nerves also which do both the functions. Yes, when it comes to human nervous system,
ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, could you just stay on the slide for a minute?
This PPT will be shared to you. You can later check if you have any doubts. Okay?
Yeah, ma'am, just 1 minute.
Okay, fine. What? Your voice is not audible.
Ma'am, I had doubts on the previous animal hormones thing. Is adrenaline and noradrenaline, again, antagonistic hormones, or are they somewhat similar?
No, similar. Epinephrine and norepinephrine are similar. They respond to flight stress response.
So what is the difference?
The difference between epinephrine and norepinephrine. Basically, both of them are responsible in regulation of stress. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Please keep yourself in mute. I'll give the answer. Basically, these both are very similar neurotransmitters. These are basically similar neurotransmitters. But see, few epinephrine will basically act on heart. Okay, it has more effect on heart. Norepinephrine has effect on different parts of the body, like let's say blood vessel. Okay, so they have difference in function only on different parts of the body. Their function is same, but they are act on different parts of the body. That is the difference. But they have a similar function. It is not like glucagon and insulin. They have similar function, but they act on different parts of the body. Understood?
Yes, ma'am, got it.
Yes. Guys, concentrate on the class. I can see many messages here which are not relevant to the subject. Yeah, if you have any doubts uncleared, I'll check the chat box later and we'll discuss those, okay? Yes, when it comes to nervous system, again, this has a nervous system is basically divided into central nervous system, peripheral nervous system. We'll see what are the functions of each one of those in detail and what are the different parts that are coming under each section, okay? Yes. Human nervous system, it is divided into central nervous system and peripheral nervous system. Central nervous system consists of brain and spinal cord. It comprises of brain and spinal cord. Peripheral nervous system, it consists of cranial nerves and spinal nerves. Okay. So here you can see this is central nervous system. It includes brain and spinal cord. But what about peripheral nervous system? Brain and spinal cord will send the information to different parts of the body and take the information from different parts of the body to the spinal nerves and cranial nerves. Okay, cranial nerves are those which are connected to cranium. Spinal nerves are those which are connected to spinal cord. So you can see here in this picture, see there are few cranial nerves which are connected to cranium and these are the spinal nerves. So this is peripheral nervous system and this is central nervous system. Yes. Yeah. And what is the basic unit of nervous system? Basic unit of nervous system is neuron. Neuron is the one which helps in transfer of impulses or passing the information from one part of the body, to other part. Okay. So neuron is also called as nerve cell. Yeah. And the structure of neuron is very important. And the parts has to be labeled clearly. Okay. So what is a neuron? Neuron is a structural and functional unit of nervous system. and it has, it is made up of cell body which is known as cyton, and it is made up of an axon, and it has axon terminals. Okay, so cell body is also called as cyton. Cell body have small thread-like structures, root hair-like structures, which are known as dendrites, which help in taking the information towards the neuron, or which helps sometimes giving the information towards the other neurons also. Okay, so dendrites basically act as a mediators to pass the information from one neuron to the other neuron. Okay, once the information is carried by dendrites, it sends back the information to the cyton, cell body. Yes, cell body has the nucleus, and it also have cytoplasm which has small granules. Those granules which are present inside the cytoplasm of the cell body are known as Nissl granules. NISSLEGRANULES. Nissl granules are present in the cytoplasm of cyton, or cell body. Okay. This cyton will extend and it leads to the formation of axon. Axon is a small, thin structure, tube-like structure, okay, and it helps in passing the information from cyton towards the axon terminals. Okay, these axons are this basically, okay, axon is again, it sends the information and will go to the, information will be sent to the axon terminals or nerve endings. Okay,
now in between, like what sends it from the dendrite to the axon?
From dendrite, the information will be sent to the cyton. Cyton will send the information back to the axon. Axon will take this information and it will transfer towards the axon terminals or nerve endings.
Ma'am, but through what does it send it? You said
yes. I will tell it. I'll repeat it. Okay. The information will be sent from cyton to the axon, axon to the axon terminals. Okay. And here you can see, in between there is a gap between these axons. There is a small gap-like structures. These gaps are known as nodes of Ranvier's. The rest of this is covered with myelin sheath. And here you can see, let me draw the structure and show it to you. That will be more clear. See. So this is the cyton. From cyton, it is leading to the formation of axon. Axon will send the information towards the dendrites, right? This is a rough diagram. This axon is very thin and it is covered by myelin sheath. It is covered by myelin sheath. Okay. This here in this particular place, it is not covered by myelin sheath. This is known as nodes of Ranvier. This is known as nodes of Ranvier. So what is the significance of nodes of Ranvier? We'll talk about that. Okay, so now you're clear with the structure and different parts of the axon, different parts of the neuron. Okay, so there are two different types of neurons. One is myelinated neurons, other is non-myelinated neurons or unmyelinated neurons. Myelinated neurons means it is covered with myelin sheath. Unmyelinated or non-myelinated neurons means they are not covered with myelin sheath. So what is the importance of this myelin sheath? Myelin sheath is acting as an insulator. Okay, it is acting as a protective covering to the axon. That is the function of myelin sheath. Why should my axon be protected? Axon should be protected because it is carrying some information from one region to the different one other region, right? So if axon is not covered, information can come from different sides of the axon also, not only from the dendrite. If it is just like this without myelinated sheath, the information come from any side of the axon, and that leads to disturbance to the actual information which is passing from dendrite towards the nerve endings, right? That is why it is covered with myelin sheath. If it is not covered, the information might not reach properly and proper response might not be seen. That is why myelin sheath is very much required. It is acting as an insulator. Yes, but you can ask me a doubt. There is a space and few information can be processed from here also. Yes, from the nodes of Ranvier, the information can be sent into the axon as it is required. But if it is open everywhere without myelin sheath, that would lead to disturbance. If one particular region is open for the information to enter the axon, that is required for the axon. Okay, so that is about the myelin sheath and its function. And yeah, there are two different. Yes.
Ma'am, can you define a dendrite again?
Dendrites are small thread-like structures which are present. Which are the continuation of cyton or the cell body. Cyton have small branched or root hair-like structure called as dendrites. Okay. And yeah, next coming to the different types of signals or different types of impulses. We have two different types of impulses, electrical impulses and chemical impulses. So messages pass through the nerve cell in the form of chemical and electrical signals called as nerve impulse. So what are nerve impulses? Nerve impulses are the chemical and electrical signals which helps in passing the messages from one neuron to the other neuron. That is nerve impulse. Okay, so the dendrites, so if let us think the information is sent from the one particular cell and it is passed to the dendrites. Dendrites will please keep yourself in mute. Yeah, now the dendrites will take this information. That is the chemical, the dendrites receive the information and starts the chemical reaction. So the chemical response is sent to the dendrites and dendrites will process that information and convert the chemical signals into electrical signals. Once it is converted into electrical signals, so dendrites will pass the information to the cyton. The electrical signals are converted to chemical signals or chemical impulses in the cyton. And this cyton will carry the electrical signals throughout the axon. From cyton, the information electrical signals will be passed throughout the axon. And when it comes to the nerve endings, again these electrical impulses are converted to chemical impulses. The chemical, how is it converted? There are few neurotransmitters here. These neurotransmitters which have receptors will take the electrical signals and convert into chemical signals. Once the neurotransmitters will take these chemical signals, they will transfer this information to the synapse. Synapse is a gap between one neuron ending to the next neuron. Okay, it is a junction between two neurons. So these chemical impulses or chemical signals from neurotransmitters will transfer towards the synapse, which is the junction between two neurons, and from the junction there are receptors in the next neuron. That receptors will take this information and give the information again to the dendrites. This is how the information is transferred or passed from one neuron to the next neuron. Okay, let us see how it transfers from one neuron to the next neuron. Yes, here this is one nerve ending. And let us think this is one more nerve. Okay. And here there are different receptors for neurotransmitters, and now these neurotransmitters like dopamine, acetylcholine, they have these other different neurotransmitters. Now these neurotransmitters.
Excuse me, ma'am. Yes. Could you explain what gray matter is?
I didn't start the brain itself. I'm just explaining what is neuron.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. So this is presynaptic neuron. And this is postsynaptic neuron. So now the information had come throughout the axon and it has come to nerve endings here. In the nerve endings, we have different receptors for neurotransmitters. Neurotransmitters are now ready here. They're active. They're activated by calcium-gated channels. And these neurotransmitters will burst open and send the chemical signals towards these receptors which are present here. These are the receptors you can see here. And now this information will be sent to the synapse. This is the synapse. This is the synapse. And now the information will come here. And the receptors are ready here on the postsynaptic membrane also. You can see here this is the postsynaptic neuron. And the receptors are ready here. And those signals will come, chemical signals come and bind to these receptors. And now the information will enter the postsynaptic neuron. So this is one neuron. This is the second neuron. The information will come from here, from the presynaptic neuron to postsynaptic neuron. This is how the information is passed from one neuron to the next neuron. Hope everyone are clear with this. Yeah, that is about neuron and nerve cell. See here, this is the transmission of messages through neurons. Yeah, this is the presynaptic neuron and this is the postsynaptic neuron. This is the synapse. Okay, this is how the information is transported. I have shown you in like easier way so that you can understand how it actually happens. Yes. Yeah, now let us come to the brain. It is very much important. Central nervous system, it comprises of brain and spinal cord, as I have told. Let us talk about brain here. Yeah, brain is the main coordinating center in the human body. You all know brain is very much useful for controlling and coordinating our body. Brain is basically protected by a cranium. It is protected by cranium. And it is also covered by three membranes are also called as meninges. These three membranes are called as meninges, which is filled with a fluid. That fluid is known as cerebrospinal fluid, CSF. So what is the function of CSF? It protects from the shocks. Okay, it will protect the brain from, or it protects the brain from, or skull from the stress or shock. Okay, the brain is basically made up of three parts. That is divided into three parts, forebrain, midbrain and hindbrain. The forebrain, let me show the diagram first. Yes, here, as you can see, is how the structure of brain, human brain. It has different lobes like parietal lobe, frontal lobe, occipital lobe and temporal lobe. It has four lobes and yes, the forebrain consists of basically cerebrum and olfactory lobes. It is what is the function of forebrain? It comprises of cerebrum and olfactory lobes. So it has particular function. What is the function done by forebrain? It helps basically in thinking. Like we have processivity, right? If you get the information, so if there is a vehicle coming from towards you, you will move towards the other side. Because you need to protect yourself. That analysis is given to you. The thinking process is given to you by forebrain. Right? And also it controls voluntary actions. Whatever voluntary, there are involuntary actions and voluntary actions done by you. Voluntary actions are done which are under your control. Which are under your control of your will. Those are voluntary actions. All those are controlled by this cerebrum. Okay. It controls the touch, smell, hearing, taste, sight and mental activities like thinking, learning, memory and emotions, etc. These are controlled by forebrain. Okay. And next comes the midbrain. Midbrain is basically, it controls the involuntary actions and also reflect movements of head, neck and eyes. This is the function of midbrain. And what is the function of hindbrain? Hindbrain basically it includes cerebellum, pons, veroli and medulla oblongata. You can see here in the next slide, you can see the pons, veroli. This is basically known as brain stem. It includes pons veroli, medulla, okay, cerebellum, right? So, yeah, this forebrain is also called, it includes pons veroli, medulla oblongata, and spinal cord. And let us see the functions. Cerebellum, it basically controls the body movements and it helps in balancing of the body. Posture and balance to the body is given by cerebellum. And what about pons veroli? Pons veroli, it controls respiration of the body. Medulla oblongata, it controls the blood pressure, heartbeat, and it also helping in swallowing, coughing, such functions. Okay, these are different functions of forebrain, midbrain, and hindbrain. And yeah, forebrain is also called as prosencephalon. Forebrain is also called as prosencephalon. What is prosencephalon? Forebrain. Okay. Midbrain is also called as mesencephalon. Hindbrain is also called as rhombencephalon. Rhombencephalon. These are other names for forebrain, midbrain, and hindbrain. Forebrain includes...
Ma'am?
Yes?
Ma'am, could you just write those three names down, please?
Yes. Forebrain is called as prosencephalon. Prosencephalon, and midbrain is called as mesencephalon, hindbrain is called as rhombencephalon. Okay, these are known, these are different names for forebrain, midbrain, and hindbrain. Okay, so forebrain, I told it includes cerebrum, which is the largest part of the brain. 80% of the brain is occupied by forebrain. And it also includes diencephalon and olfactory lobes. So these are three different parts which are included in forebrain. One is cerebrum, the next one is olfactory lobes, and diencephalon. Diencephalon. These are included under forebrain. Under midbrain and optic lobes, which are also called as corpora quadra gemina, and also cerebral peduncles. Basically, these details are very much important for the autonomous students. Midbrain comprises of optic lobes and cerebral peduncles. Optic lobes are also known as corpora quadra gemina. They are present in corpora quadra gemina. Cerebral peduncles are present in crura cerebri. Okay. And hindbrain, as I told, it has brainstem. What are those present in hindbrain? Cerebellum, pons veroli, and medulla oblongata. And the functions are very much clear. Okay. And I told you they have four lobes also. They are frontal lobe, parietal lobe, occipital lobe, and temporal lobe. As you can see here, these are the four lobes present in the human brain. Okay. Yes. Next, coming functions, you are clear with the functions also? Yeah. Let us go to the next, spinal cord. Now you are clear with the brain. Next, let us see the second part of the central nervous system. Second part of central nervous system is spinal cord. The spinal cord is the continuation of brainstem. You can see here. Yes, from here it continues as a spinal cord from medulla oblongata. The spinal cord starts from the brain and extends throughout the vertebral column. It extends throughout the vertebral column. And it has different nerves, which are known as spinal nerves. There are 31 pairs of spinal nerves. There are cranial nerves also. Cranial nerves are 12 pairs, whereas spinal nerves are 31 pairs. Okay. So what is the function of these nerves? They carry the information to and from the brain, towards the brain also and away from the brain also. The informations are carried by these nerves. Okay. And also it controls the reflex actions. The spinal cord is very much required for controlling the reflex actions. So what is reflex action? We'll see. Okay. So these spinal nerves are five types. Those spinal nerves are five types. They are divided into cervical nerves, thoracic nerves, lumbar nerves, sacral nerves and coccygeal nerves. Okay. So you can see here 8 pairs of cervical nerves are there and 12 pairs of thoracic nerves are there. And lumbar nerves are 5 pairs, sacral nerves are 5 pairs and the rest out 2 pairs which are combined to form only one nerve, that is known as coccygeal nerve. This is how the nerves are divided: cranial nerves, thoracic nerves, lumbar nerves, sacral nerves and coccygeal nerves. If you go with a back pain to a doctor, he will do a scan and tell you that there is a gap between C2 and C3. That means there is a gap between C2 nerve and C3 nerve, cranial nerve. Okay. If they tell there is gap between T4 and T5, it means there is some damage in the thoracic nerve region. Okay. That is how there are different regions in the spinal cord. Yes. That is about spinal cord. I told spinal cord is very much required for.
Could you just repeat the number of each type of nerve again?
Yes, cranial cervical nerves, it has 8 pairs. Thoracic, 12 pairs.
Yes, ma'am.
Next, lumbar and sacral. Lumbar, 5 pairs and sacral, 5 pairs.
Yes, ma'am.
And coccygeal, 1 pair.
Yes, ma'am. Got it.
Two nerves are combined to form one. Yeah.
Yes.
Done? Yes. Next comes to the reflex action. So what is reflex action? Reflex action is a sudden, unconscious, involuntary response of the effectors towards a stimulus. Okay. Suddenly you touch a hot object, you remove your hand. Like suddenly you stamp on a prick, on a thorn, you'll remove your leg. That is reflex action. Sudden actions which are done unconsciously are known as reflex actions. Okay. So these are few examples. We suddenly withdraw our hand if we suddenly touch a hot object. Right? You'll not give time to time to burn your fingers or hands. You'll remove suddenly because that is an unconscious response given by your spinal cord. Okay. So in this reflex action, the nerves in the skin, those are the receptors that detects the heat and pass the message towards the sensory nerves. These sensory nerves will not take the information towards the brain. They in turn takes the information towards the spinal cord. So the processivity is little longer if the information is taken towards the brain. It will take a longer time to respond. But the spinal cord can respond very quick when compared to the brain. Brain also will respond very quickly. Like the information will be sent more faster by the spinal cord. So these sudden unconscious responses are the information is sent to the spinal cord rather than brain. So now, the information will be sent to the spinal cord. Spinal cord have both sensory nerves and motor nerves also. Sensory nerves will take the information and motor nerves or the motor neurons will take back the response given by the spinal cord and it will send the information back to the effector. See, you can see here in the diagram. See, this is the response. Your receptor is the skin and sensory neuron is taking the information. It is taking towards the spinal cord. The spinal cord will analyze the information. There is a neuron which is known as interneuron or relay neuron. Interneuron is also called as relay neuron. like in class, I have told you the examples. Like we have a relay game where the particular dumbbell is exchanged by four people, and like it is a team work, right? Relay. The same way here also, it is a teamwork by sensory neurons, relay neurons, and motor neurons. Relay neurons will take the information from the sensory, and they analyze the information. Analysis is done by the spinal cord. I will explain the gray matter and white matter in the spinal cord. And this interneuron will in turn send the information back towards the motor neuron. Okay, this motor neuron will take the information, whatever is given by the spinal cord, response, and it will send the information to the effector. Clear? This is known as reflex arc. This particular thing, whatever mechanism, this is known as reflex arc. The complete action or the function is known as reflex action. Okay, clear? Now let us see what is the difference between gray matter and white matter. Yes. This is how you need to draw the diagram when the reflex action is asked. And one of you has asked the difference between gray matter and white matter. So as the name itself, it is self-explanatory. Gray matter, because it is gray in color, it is known as gray matter. And white matter, because it is white in color. So gray matter here, gray matter will have basically cell bodies and dendrites. Gray matter basically have only cell bodies and dendrites. Whereas white matter, it has more of it has more myelinated neurons, and also it have here in the gray matter, it has only cell bodies and dendrites, but in the white matter, it also have complete neurons. It also have myelinated neurons. Basically, myelinated neurons are present in the white matter.
So do glial cells come under gray matter or white matter?
Yes. Wait. One second. Yes, yes. Yeah. One second, yeah. I am telling you, yeah, gray matter has only cell bodies and dendrites. White matter have myelinated axons and neurons. The complete set of things are present in white matter. So glial cells, like what are the glial cells? These are the cells that secrete myelin sheath. Glial cells and these, please mute.
Ma'am, I have a doubt.
Yes, if you have a doubt, please send it in the comment box. Okay, these satellite cells, there are five types of cells which secrete these myelin sheath. These cells are basically present in the white matter, which helps in secretion of the myelin sheath. Okay, astrocytes, glial cells, all these are present in the white matter.
Ma'am?
One second, let me complete what is gray matter, differences between gray matter and white matter. Yeah, gray matter, it is present in brain also, it is present in spinal cord also. White matter, it is also present in brain and spinal cord, right? So these are the differences between gray matter and white matter. And function wise, yes, Shraddha, you have some doubt?
Ma'am, can you repeat the name of the cells that like help in production of myelin sheath?
Astrocytes. Astrocytes, glial cells. Done, Shraddha?
Yes, ma'am.
Quan cells also produce.
So these cells which produce the myelin sheath, they don't have any receptors or any places to receive the neurotransmitters, is it?
Like, yeah, these also will act based on signals only. Whenever it is required only, they will secrete the myelin sheath. If it is not required, it doesn't secrete. But 90% of our neurons are myelinated.
The induction of the signal, this doesn't play any role.
This also... No.
Yes, got it.
It doesn't play any role. Okay. Done. Next. Yes. So these are different representations of reflex action. You can see here clearly what is white matter and what is gray matter. Clearly than the last diagram. And you can see here the difference between sensory neuron, relay neuron. Sensory neuron is represented with blue color, relay neuron with green, and motor neuron with red color. Okay, so these are different. This is the easiest way to represent the reflex arc. However, this will be shared with you, so you can go through that. Yes, so this is about central nervous system and peripheral nervous system. Yeah, there are spinal nerves and cranial nerves which help in response. Basically, they send the messages. They have sensory neurons, motor neurons, and interneurons which help in taking the information from receptor towards the brain and the spinal cord, from brain and spinal cord again back towards the effector. That is about peripheral nervous system. Okay. So, yes. Yes.
Now you didn't explain the functions of the matter.
Functions of the matter. This gray matter and the white matter.
Yes.
Okay. First thing is location is very important. And next, what are the components present in it? That is also important. Okay. And basically white this gray matter is helpful in white matter, it helps in basically taking the information. Gray matter will helps in analyzing the information. That is the basic difference between white matter and gray matter.
Ma'am, could you repeat that?
White matter, it consists of myelinated axons which are passing to and from the brain or different segments of the spinal cord. Whereas gray matter, it consists of only cell bodies and dendrites. White matter helps in taking the information or sending the taking the information or response from the effector, and gray matter basically helps in analyzing the information. Analyzing the information. That is the major difference. Okay. Yes. Next, we have to discuss about the coordination in plants also. We have discussed in animals. Hope everyone are clear. And in plants, it is controlled and coordinated. There is no as such nervous system and endocrine system in plants. There are phytohormones, which are known as plant hormones, which are also a chemical substances which helps in coordination in plants. Okay, so there are five different types of plant hormones. They are auxins, gibberellins or gibberellins, however you pronounce, and cytokinins, abscisic acid and ethylene. These are five different hormones or phytohormones which are present in plants, which helps in coordination and control in plants. So among these, first three of them are growth promoters, whereas last two of them are growth inhibitors. Auxins, gibberellins and cytokinins are growth promoters, whereas abscisic acid and ethylene are growth inhibitors. So auxins help in basically cell division and cell elongation. So they help in vertical and horizontal growth. Auxins help in vertical and horizontal growth. They help in cell division and elongation. Gibberellins, they help in growth of stem and branches. They help in growth of stem and branches. Both of these have more or less same functions, auxins and gibberellins. Cytokinins, again, they are again coordinated. Auxins are coordinated with gibberellins. Auxins are again coordinated with cytokinins. and together they help in cell division and also ripening of fruits, formation of fruits and seeds. They help in formation of fruits and seeds, not ripening, formation of fruits and seeds. Okay, so that is also one type of growth seen in plants. So you can see all of these three are responsible for growth promotion. Now let's come to abscisic acid. Abscisic acid inhibits the growth and they also help in wilting of leaves. They inhibit the growth and helps in wilting of leaves. Ethylene, again it helps in flowering and ripening of fruits. So these are five different hormones which are responsible in controlling and coordination in plants. Yes, next is types of movements. Types of movements which are very important. See in plants, again tropic movements. These are the directional movements towards or away from the stimulus. It depends on the growth. So there are different types of movements again. Phototrophism, zeotrophism, chemotrophism and hydrotrophism. Phototrophism is nothing but bending towards the light or away from the light. So phototrophism is a movement or a response given by the plant towards the light. If the plant is bending towards the light, then it is a positive phototrophism. Bending of shoot towards the light. Okay, that is positive phototrophism. If it is moving away from the light, it is a negative phototrophism. Bending of root away from light, that is negative phototrophism. So that is phototrophism. And next comes geotrophism. Geo itself, you can understand, it is towards the earth or away from the earth. Basically, it is towards the gravitational force or away from the gravitational force. So geotrophism is a response or the movement of the plant towards the gravity. So if it is movement is towards the gravity, then it is positive geotrophism. It is downward growth of roots. Roots grow towards the gravity. That is positive response. If it is away from the gravity, then it is negative response. Upward growth of shoot. Shoot is growing up away from the gravity. It is negative. Negative response shown by the shoot. That is negative geotrophism. Next is chemotrophism. Trophism means movement. Chemo means chemical response. It is a response shown by the plant towards the chemical stimulus. So yes, growth of pollen tube towards the ovule. Pollen tube will be grown towards the ovule due to the small chemical stimulus. Because of the, yes, you can use the sugar syrup also. If you do an experiment in the lab, you can use sugar syrup. And if you put the pollen grains in that, you can see the pollen tube growth. So such compound, which is a sugar or carbohydrate chemical compound, is present and that helps in growth of the pollen tube. That is known as response towards the chemicals. Hydrotrophism is response towards the water, right? Response towards the water, that is hydrotrophism. Growth of roots towards the water, that is an example for yes, that is the response towards the hydrotrophism. Yes, again few examples here about the again that I didn't discuss the functions of testis and ovary. Testis in males produce a hormone testosterone which controls the sperm production and change during the puberty, and ovary secretes the hormone progesterone and estrogen which have different roles, and that would be discussed in the reproductive system. So I didn't discuss much in detail here. Yes, so that is about endocrine system and nervous system. So I'll give you 2 minutes. Please come with your doubts. Yes, noradrenaline could be either dopamine or serotonin. Sympathetic. Wait, let me check. Okay, do you have doubt in autonomic nervous system? See, peripheral nervous system is again divided into somatic and autonomic nervous system. I didn't go into much detail because it is not required for you. Peripheral nervous system, as I have told, it has functions like sympathetic and parasympathetic functions. Both of them will function antagonistic to each other. Yes, I'll discuss one more thing here, the difference between sympathetic and parasympathetic. They both work antagonistic to each other, parasympathetic and sympathetic nervous system. Let me tell you the major difference between sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system. Yes. So, sympathetic nervous system, it basically prepares the body during emergency situations. Okay, parasympathetic, it maintains the functions, normal functions of the body. And parasympathetic nervous system basically helps during responding the body towards the when the body is at rest. So sympathetic will function during emergency conditions, whereas parasympathetic will function during the rest. Okay, that is the main difference between sympathetic nervous system and parasympathetic nervous system. And sympathetic tenses you. It is not sympathetic will tense you. It responds during the emergency conditions. Let's say the function has to be done immediately. That would be done by sympathetic. Parasympathetic will do the normal functions which are required by the body. It is not related to tension as such. Okay, and same mechanism as central nervous system for signal conduction too. Yeah, I have discussed about the white matter and gray matter. Done. So, yes, these are the doubts. Yes, if you have any doubts, yes, I will welcome those doubts also. Meanwhile, I will discuss few important questions which are coming from this chapter. I have worksheet which includes 64 questions which are coming from this chapter, and I have given solutions for those also. Yes, let us see few questions here. How is the spinal cord protected in the human body? It is covered by a bony cage called vertebral column. These are very small questions, one word answers. Here you need to write that keyword. You need not write paragraphs of answer here. The examiner will be expecting only the keyword. Here the keyword is, it is enclosed in a vertebral column. That is more than enough. Okay, so yes, here again an experiment analytic question is given. A potted plant is made to lie horizontally on the ground. Which part of the plant will show positive zoetrophism? Which part will show negative zoetrophism? Just root and shoot is the answer. Okay, so the examiner will be looking for only one, that keyword. Okay, let us see one more question here. Name the sixth question. Name the plant hormone which help in promoting cell division, growth of the stem and roots. you know that is auxin. Auxin will help in cell division, and also cytokinin will help in cell division. Growth of the stem and roots is done by gibberellin. So you can write all those three hormones. And here cell division is done by cytokinins and auxins also. Growth of the stem is done by gibberellins. That can be written. Okay. And next, however, this worksheet will be given to you. Let us see one more seventh question. What is the function of thyroxine hormone? Thyroxine is the hormone secreted by thyroid gland. You need not write all those details. They ask you only the function of that hormone. Thyroxine will help in regulating our metabolism. It helps in regulation of metabolism. What metabolism, if you want to write it in detail? Carbohydrate, protein and fat metabolism in the body. That is enough. You need not write all the details, that where is thyroid gland present and what is its function, what are the hormones secreted by them, what are the disorders. All these are not required. Just be up to the point while you are writing very short answer questions. That is one markers. Okay. Yes. And next comes, let us see a few more important questions. 10th question. Name the part of the brain which controls the posture and balance. It is the cerebellum. Cerebellum is the one which controls the posture. So only that one word is expected from you. Yes, such questions are asked in few exams. Why is it advised to use iodized salt in our diet? It is related to thyroid gland, you know. Otherwise, it leads to a disorder known as goiter. If there is no proper amount of iodine, it leads to goiter. Iodine stimulates the thyroid gland to produce thyroxines. Deficiency of this hormone results in enlargement of thyroid gland, which can lead to goiter. That is why, please mute. Guys, who is that? Bhumika, please mute. Yes. Yeah. So we were discussing 13th question. Yeah.
Ma'am? Is like the meninges covering the spinal cord also, or is it only for the brain?
Meninges are covering only the cranium. The spinal cord is covered by vertebral column.
Ma'am, in our textbook, it's there as the meninges protect the CNS. So that consists of the brain and the spinal cord.
Mainly it covers the cranium. The meninges only cover the cranium. Okay.
So not the spinal cord.
No.
Ma'am, could you show up from the 9th question?
9th question, yes. Yeah. Which one of the following actions on touch is an example for chemical control? See, movement of human leg is basically, it is controlled by what? So when you see, human leg movement is, it has calcium channels, troponin and tropomyosin, which will control the movement. Like this is a whole mechanism. But here, let's say touch me not plant. It is basically the receptors. Chemical control. Both of these actions are example for chemical control. But if you take in more, when you compare with plant and human leg, plant is completely a human control, completely a chemical control. Human leg is controlled by many other like many other factors also, like ATP is controlled, like actin, myosin, troponin, tropomyosin, calcium, all these factors will come into picture when you take moment in human leg. But here in plants, it is completely a chemical control. Okay, so that is why the answer is touch sensitive plants. Yes, so these are few questions for very short answer type. Yeah, let us see here. What is the significance of reflex action? It helps in giving a very quick response. That is the importance. Yeah, you can give the examples for chemotropism. That is not a problem. See, what are the nacelle granules? Where are nacelle granules found? And what is its nature? This is very important. Nacelle granules, I told you, they are present in the cyton and dendrites, in the neuron. Okay. So their nature, basically they are made up of RNAs, ribonucleic acid. That is the nature of nacelle granules. So this is how very short answers has to be answered. Like up to the point, you need not write any extra thing for very short answer questions. Yes, next comes to the two markers, short answer type questions. So what is a synapse? In a neuron cell, how is an electrical impulse created, and what is the role of synapse in this contest? So when such questions are given, first write the, it has two parts. It has three parts basically. What is a synapse? Second part of the question is neuronal cell, in the neuronal cell, how electrical impulse is created, and what is the role of synapse in this contest? See, when such questions are given, you people write the first part and you'll forget the second part. You write first and second part, you forget to write third part. When such questions are given, read the question completely and think what has to be written here. Don't just write the first part and come. You'll lose the mark. You'll get only half a mark. Okay? So, synapse is a junction or a gap between two neurons. Right?
Ma'am, the 25th question, ma'am.
I'm just discussing 21st question. I'll go back to that question also. So, what is a synapse? It is a junction between two neurons. Done. In a neuron cell, how is an electrical signal created? Here, the axon terminal of one neuron is close proximity to the dendrite of the second neuron. As I have shown in the picture there, you can see that when a neuron impulse reaches, when the nerve impulse reaches the knob of nerve ending of an axon, a tiny amount of chemical substance is released to the synapse. This chemical substance is known as neurotransmitters. As I have shown in the diagram here, see, here is the nerve ending of presynaptic neuron. The chemical receptors are present here inside. These are released towards the receptor, and from the receptor, they are released towards the synapse. From synapse, again, it will go towards the postsynaptic membrane. When it goes to the postsynaptic membrane, yes, this chemical substance is called a neurotransmitter. At synapse, the electrical signals converted into chemicals that can easily cross over the gap and pass to the next neuron, where it again converted into chemical signals. So that is the importance of synapse here. That is how that is the answer which is required for this particular answer. Yeah. So next question you can write, that is the direct question. What is reflex action? All those. Name the hormone secreted. Yes, that 23rd question is also direct. And name and explain the function of hormone secreted by pituitary gland in human. Yes, when the pituitary gland is asked, write down all the functions. Hormones also divided into anterior pituitary and posterior pituitary. Write the hormones secreted by anterior pituitary and posterior pituitary in detail. That is also a direct question. Yes, 25th question. What are the nastic and curvature moments? Give one example of each. So nastic moments are non-directional moments which are neither towards or away from the stimulus. Dropping of leaves is just an example. Curvature moments, yes, phototropism, geotropism, all these are curvature moments. Okay, so this is the question asked repeatedly in like many of the years. Nastic moments and curvature moments. Very important question. Okay, and yeah, name the write the name and the function of any two parts of human hindbrain. Who is that? Meninges is the thin covering of the brain and consisting of dura or yes.
Ma'am, the meninges cover the spinal cord and the brain.
See, basically, if they ask how is it protected, spinal cord is protected by vertebral column. Brain is basically protected by meninges and cranium. Okay, and see, meninges are present in the both ways. Protection is given by, for the spinal cord, it is given by this vertebral column only. That is what I meant. I didn't tell it is not at all present. It is protected. You asked me how is it protected. Then I answered it is protected by vertebral column. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes, next let us see few more questions. Yeah, next all of these are direct questions. What are plant hormones? Write two important functions of auxins. Auxins help in cell division and cell elongation, promotes growth. Plant hormones, you know, chemical substances which are helpful in translocation or regulating the plant physiology. And yes, in two marks questions, the questions are asked directly. It will be definitions and the functions. And yeah, in every question, important thing you need to remember is if example is present, if you know the examples, it is like you are requested to write the examples. Even if it is asked or not asked in biology, if you write the examples, it is like extra thing you are writing and you can easily fetch the marks. Examiner will come to know this particular person, know the concept by seeing your example itself. Don't wait for the examiner or the question to be asked, in the question to be asked to write the examples. If you know the examples, please mention those examples also. Underline the examples. Underline the keywords. That is how you can fetch full marks in biology. Okay, so these are the direct questions. And yeah, distinguish between spinal nerves and cranial nerves. Yes, spinal nerves are present in the spinal cord. Cranial nerves are present in the brain. And number of them, 31 pairs of spinal nerves. And cranial nerves are 12 pairs. That is how you can distinguish, because there are, for two markers, you can write 4 points. So 4 points are here. That is more than enough. Yeah, how does control and coordination takes place in plants? It takes place by phytohormones. Phytohormones examples are those 5 hormones you can tell. In addition, environmental factors like water, temperature, light also controls growth and development. Yes, apart from phytohormones. And what is the difference between cerebellum and cerebrum? Yes. Cerebrum, it is the largest, highly developed and prominent part of the brain. 80% of it is occupied, 80% of the brain is occupied by cerebrum. Guys, please do not disturb the class. Mute. And cerebellum, it is the second largest part of the brain and it lies in the posterior part of the brain. Cerebrum will come under forebrain, cerebellum will come under hindbrain. Yes, and the function of cerebrum is to control the sense, thinking process, memory, intelligence, whereas cerebellum helps in balancing the body and posture, balancing and posture. That is the difference between cerebrum and cerebellum. And yeah, the sympathetic nervous system and parasympathetic nervous system, the differences, as I have told you, which controls the emergency and which responds when it is in rest. And there are a few more things. It prepares the body for abnormal situations, that is emergency. Nerve fibers connect these ganglia with central nervous system and visceral organs, whereas in the parasympathetic nervous system, its original place is in brain and it connects with the posterior part of the brain. Okay, so these are few points about sympathetic and parasympathetic. In that way, few differences will be asked. And yeah, when three markers are asked, this would be little twisted questions or indirect questions or explanatory questions. Whereas one markers or two markers will be direct questions, like direct questions will be there. So you need not worry about them. And here, they have given a question like this. Smita's father has been advised by a doctor to reduce his sugar intake. Name the disease he is suffering from and name the hormone whose deficiency is. Identify the gland that secretes it and mention the function of hormone. Basically, they're asking about one particular hormone and whole details of that hormone. By seeing the first thing itself, you'll know that it is related to diabetes, sugar intake. So, diabetes. The hormone control is insulin and glucagon, which increases the level, which decreases the level. And gland is pancreas. So that is how you need to write the answer. And second question is direct question. They're asking the functions of hormones, which is direct again. Yes. How is the brain protected from injury and shock? Cerebrospinal fluid and cranium meninges help in protection. Name two main parts of the brain, hind brain, that is cerebellum, medulla oblongata, and pons, and state their functions. You know the functions. And nerve cell. When the diagram of nerve cell is asked, everyone will draw it. Please draw it with a pencil and mention the label the parts and label the parts towards one side of the book. Please don't label it towards all the directions, all the possible directions. Okay, when you are labeling, please make sure that you will not put an arrow mark. Just put a line like this. Don't draw an arrow mark. Put a line. And that line should be all the parts has to be labeled towards one side. And if you take a paper, diagram should be towards the left side and the labeling should be towards the right side. And don't draw it very big. It looks really odd. Please draw it in a medium, okay, medium size. Don't draw it very small, don't draw it very big. Both of them doesn't look good. So all the parts has to be labeled. That is how, yeah, this is a direct question. See, again here they have asked AB, draw and name the part of the neuron. And again they have asked where the information is acquired, through which information travels as an electrical impulse. Electrical impulse is traveled outside the neuron, like completely like dendrite and axon. In like core part of the neuron, that is cyton and axon carries. Sorry. Through which information travels is an electrical impulse. Is outside the neuron, it is completely chemical impulse. Inside the neuron, it is electrical impulse. As yeah. Cyton and axon, dendrite, they carry the electrical impulse, whereas synapse will carry, axon endings will carry chemical impulse. Yes, again question will be asked to draw the structure of brain. So you need not draw all the meninges, you need not draw all the lobes. You need to show what is the forebrain, what is the midbrain, what is the hindbrain. Here they have asked, You simply draw the structure of the brain, and they have asked draw the NEET diagram of human brain and label midbrain and pituitary gland. So label only those two parts, whatever parts are asked to label, label only those two parts. Okay, that is how specific parts will be asked to label. Yes, and this is how the three markers are asked. And again, direct question, three directional moments, phototropism, zeotropism, all those, how brain and spinal cord are protected in human. One is by cranium, one is by vertebral column. Name the master gland present in the brain. And you know, pituitary gland. See, hypothalamus is not given in your textbook. Hypothalamus is the master gland for pituitary gland. But pituitary is the master gland, which is controls the functions of many parts of the body. And yeah, next question is also direct. This is how you need to write. Here they have asked, what is hydrotropism? Describe an experiment to demonstrate hydrotropism. So you need to tell what is hydrotropism, define and show it, show the experiment, hydrotropism, movement of roots towards the water, and also you can write little explanation about this diagram. Okay. So this is about, yeah, and these are five markers, long answer type questions. Again, here also, see, twisting can be done only in the three markers. Not only, in the, most of the time it is done in three markers. In five markers, again, you can see the direct, most of the time, direct questions only. Like important questions, what are reflex actions? Draw the structure of neuron, label the different parts and write the functions of each part. And yeah, and again, reflex arc and they will ask, sometimes they will ask only the flow chart, sometimes they will ask the diagram. See, here they have asked, suggest six reflex actions of the body. Explain how the reflex arc is the same in all of them. So here, this question, you have to tell different reflex actions. So when we, these are six different actions. When we see a speeding car moving towards us, we move aside. We withdraw our hands when we touch a hot object. We withdraw our legs or legs when we step on a prick or thorn. That is one more type. We close our eyes when there is a direct sunlight falls on our receptors. We close our eyes on we close our ears and hearing to a loud noise. We shiver when we feel cold. So these are few different actions which are done. And how are they regulated? In all of them, the same mechanism of reflex action is seen. Receptors, sensory neurons will take information towards the spinal cord. Interneurons will act and give the information back from motor neurons towards the effector. This is the mechanism. Please guys, do not disturb the class. Whoever is doing that, mute. Done. Next is, so such questions will be asked. Yeah, so that is about five markers, three markers, two markers and one markers. So this is about neuron, nervous system and endocrine system. If you have doubts, it is open for you for doubts, other 5 minutes. This is the end of the session, and if you, this is the time for you. Yes.
This is totally out of topic, but still, can you just explain what briefly, in brief, what stem cell therapy is?
Stem cells are self-renewing cells. Stem cells can be, these stem cells can form any part of our body. These stem cells are different types, which are pluripotent, multipotent, totipotent. Totipotent can form whole human or human body, whereas pluripotent can, please mute. These pluripotent cells can form except placenta, all parts of the body can be formed. Multipotent, they can form like hematopoietic stem cells. These can form a group of similar cells like blood cells. Whereas unipotent cells, they are specific to one particular organ. So these stem cells are helpful for regeneration of organs. Done. Next. Next questions.
Thank you, ma'am.
Done. Shreyas, what is the discussion going on?
Ma'am, about stem cell therapy. We were just talking about how we could clone people and stuff, so.
But there are many ethical issues. You cannot clone people.
Yes, ma'am. That's what you were talking about. Ethically, okay. Of course, it is debatable.
Yes. But yes, they're trying to regenerate few organs. Like in kidney failure for replacement of kidney, they're allowing, but not heart.
Have they ever grown a brain or anything?
See, yes, brain is done, but heart they have grown, but again, an ethical issue for heart. Because if the heart is replaced in a dying person, he can again be alive for again few more years. That is against the nature, right? So against the nature, right? So there is an ethical issue there. Kidney, yes, it is totally, kidney and liver, it is totally accepted. But for other organs,
ma'am, a few years ago, I don't really remember when, some man had a disease of the heart and the lungs. So they replaced his whole heart and lungs with mechanical.
It is just few days back. Heart replacement has happened. First successful heart replacement.
But then even before that, like a long time ago, they did that. But the man did survive. Eventually, he died.
Yeah, but it will not. Many side effects will be there. Rejections will be there.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
Highly rejection will be seen in heart because it is the main control organ.
But in the name of science, I guess we could stop the ethics debate for a while, ma'am.
But it is very important. Then people will never die. People will be immortal. That is really, against the nature.
Ma'am, is that such a bad thing?
Yeah, ma'am, but then immortality, there's stuff like cancer and stuff standing in the way because cancer happens only when you're old, right? It's like a default killing of.
It is not cancer happens in an old person. It happens in a very young boy.
No, of course. But that is because of the cataclysmic, like, bad lifestyle of the person, which increases
it is not
the
lifestyle.
Function.
Cancer do not have one reason. It has thousands of reasons why you get cancer. You cannot debate seeing only one particular reason and one particular mutation. It might be because of the sporadic or familial. If it is sporadic, it has thousands of reasons. If it is familial also, again, it is thousands of reasons. So you cannot debate on cancer and stem cells.
As far as I know, if you live too far, of course, I yes. mean, there are...
Rules are meant to be broken, ma'am.
One person at a time.
Wait for like 2 seconds.
One person at a time.
Yeah, so the thing is...
Others, please be in mute. I'll not be able to hear. Veda, please mute.
There are these genes which suppress the function of proto-oncogen on each cell, right?
Yes.
Ma'am,
suppressive genes.
Don't they become like less effective over as you age and then...
yes, definitely there is. Definitely, they will become less effective as you grow old, but they will not become mutated.
Yes, ma'am.
They will be mutated only when there is some defect, either metabolism defect or environmental defect or heredity.
And so, cancer will be like the default killing mechanism, right, by nature, because proto-oncogen is eventually going to be activated.
It is not going to become cancerous. It is controlled. Checkpoints are always regulated. If they're not eventually going to be cancerous, their function is becoming less, that's all.
So immortality is achievable but very, very difficult at the moment.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am, got it.
Yes. Veda, yes.
Ma'am, I also have another doubt.
Yes, come on.
Yes, ma'am. Is it true that zebra fishes have some kind of fluid that whenever they get hit hard on the ice in the sea rocks or something like that, they lose eyesight, but this fluid enables the eye vision again? Is it true?
I really don't know about this. I will get back to you, okay?
Fine, ma'am.
I didn't come across this. Maybe, like, I'm not sure.
Oh, yeah. Fine, ma'am.
Yeah. Others? Done. Yeah, I'll share this PPT with you, and also I'll share the worksheet with you. Yes, you have any doubt, you can come back.